Thank you for the invitation, Ronnie, and it's wonderful to be here at the official opening of the new Centre for Applied Science at NMBU. Congratulations to you on this achievement. So, how does science dispose of free will? So it seems that we can make genuine free choices. It's up to us what to do. For example, suppose I'm just walking on a Sunday afternoon in a forest. I've got no particular place to be. But I come to a fork in the path. I can go to the left or to the right. It seems it's up to me. When I look at this picture, it looks to the left, maybe it's going slightly downhill, I'm not sure. But if I fancied going downhill, I could think, okay, I'll go that way, that looks better to me, I prefer that. Or perhaps I've got a preference for always turning right. But either way, it seems when I come to this fork in the road, my decision. And when I've gone either to the left or to the right, I'll think, it was my action, I made that choice. I could have gone the other way, but I decided to go this way. But there is a challenge to this idea that we have free will. A challenge that comes from neuroscience. And this is a very famous case that gets often discussed. And it's also reached sort of popular magazines, so occasionally you'll have things like New Scientist, and you'll see this headline, "Neuroscience proves there is no free will." And the trend goes back to this famous paper. Benjamin Libet was the main first author. It appeared in a journal simply called Brain. It's a good title for a journal for neuroscience. Time of conscious intention to act in relation to onset of cerebral activity. That's the main idea. Brackets, readiness, potential. The unconscious initiation of a freely voluntary act. So this is the key paper. There's some interesting stuff in the abstract that I might come back to. But let me give you the simple idea. So the test subjects were wired up to a couple of devices. One that says EEG is measuring brain activity, cerebral activity, as it said in the title. And then the other one says EMG. That's measuring when the subject presses a button. And they're sat in front of a TV monitor. I wish this was animated, but I don't use PowerPoint very often. But what they're looking at on the screen, there's a dot going around on the clock, basically. And at some point, they can stop the clock by pressing the button. Now, the findings from this experiment were quite interesting. Here I've got a piece of technology. So here's the action, time zero, this is when there's this peak. That's when the action occurs. But here you see the W is wanting to press the button. W stands for wanting. So here the test subject wanted to press the button. And you can see it comes a little bit before they actually did press the button. The time is actually just 200 milliseconds, so that's a fifth of a second before they press the button. They wanted to press the button. But here's the really interesting and controversial finding. Much earlier than that, and I'm talking more than half a second before that, all this fantastic brain activity started, which they've recorded. So things start happening in your brain before you actually wanted to press the button. Now maybe you can think through some of the implications of that already. They say rise of RP. RP stands for readiness potential. And if ever I've heard of a name that's made up for something we don't understand, that's it. Okay, so there's all this sort of stuff going on in the brain that they're monitoring this activity, and it comes just before you act. So let's call it a readiness potential. Sounds like what it's doing. Okay, so I'm sure you can see already that there's something very interesting going on there. So this is Newton with his famous book, Principia Mathematica. Newton suggested that the physical world is governed by laws of nature. He called them axioms in his system because he worked out deductively. But he gave us this picture of a world in which every physical thing is governed by laws of motion plus the law of gravitational attraction. But hang on, your bodies are physical things too. So if this Newtonian picture is right, then your bodies are governed by the laws of nature. And Newton's system didn't allow the possibility that a physical body could suddenly opt out of the laws of nature and do what it wanted. So, you have a physical body governed by the laws of nature. Well, doesn't this suggest that we have no free will then? Because if the laws of nature dictate that I take the left path rather than the right path, then I haven't got the power to break the laws of nature. So my body is a physical thing, it's governed by physical laws. In fact, even if I had some kind of spirit or mind that was distinct from my body, and that spirit was saying, go to the right, go to the right. But my body is a physical thing. And if the laws of nature dictate that I go to the left, then nothing my mind says can affect that. It would seem. Now, the Libet experiment has been interpreted basically as suggesting that there is this kind of physical determinism. You can actually see it happening in the brain. And it's suggesting that this feeling of free will is an illusion. That it's like we are just puppets obeying not what a puppet master tells us to do, but what the laws of nature tell us to do. So this is shown in the data again, because I may feel that this decision to press the button is what made me press the button, that that was responsible for the button pressing. But this is telling me that there was this unconscious activity going on in the brain that actually preceded any decision. So if this has already started before there was any consciousness of the decision, how could I possibly say that the decision is what made me press the button? It seems it's this is what made me press the button, and that precedes the decision. Now, there's a philosophical principle that causes must precede their effects in time. Certainly, a cause can't occur after the effect. Okay. But here, well, it seems that this decision looks as if it's quite irrelevant now, because the readiness potential is already underway. And at the very least, we can say, well, I can't have decided that I wanted to activate my readiness potential. So it wasn't that I wanted to start this physical process in my brain, because the physical process has already begun before I've even had the desire to press the button. So it looks like there's a problem. And this, I think, is behind all the headlines that we get about neuroscience proving that there's no free will. This isn't the only experiment, but I think it's the most famous one. Okay, so what can we say, and what can we say as philosophers? Well, for a start, I would say it's quite hard for us to argue against the authority of science. This looks like science. There's a graph. There's numbers. You know, it'd be quite easy to get intimidated by that. Because philosophers are sometimes just accused of sitting in an armchair, just trying to think things through, being oblivious to the empirical truths, not paying any attention to them. Who are they to decide that something's false when you've got the actual empirical proof of it? Well, I think there are some useful things philosophers can say, some critical things that philosophers can say, because whether we have free will or not, I'm pretty sure, and I'm not sure about much, but I'm pretty sure that this is not a solely empirical question. It's not solely up to science to decide on this. Science is perfectly legitimate that science decides certain questions, but that doesn't mean that science can decide all the questions. There could still be a vital role for conceptual analysis, for rational considerations, the sorts of things that philosophy has. So whether determinism is true or false, that may be ultimately an empirical question. So it might be up to scientists, physicists, to tell us whether their best theory is one that's deterministic or not. There was a time, say, Newton, when the idea was of a deterministic picture of the universe, that it just worked like clockwork, a machine. But in more contemporary physics, there seems to be a role for real indeterminism in the world. So I'm happy to allow that it may be up to empirical science, namely physics, to settle the question ultimately whether determinism is true or false. But there still seem to be other questions that really are or require philosophical input, such as what is a decision? What is it to want to press a button? Now that's the sort of question where I think empirical science needs some assistance. So I'm going to move on to something that's more explicitly philosophical, but before I get to that, I'm going to just offer some rational critique of the Libet experiment on its own terms. So it's almost like I still am a scientist now, but a critical scientist. It seems to me that there's one enormous flaw, and I skated over it, but maybe it's occurred to some of you already. In fact, if I were to go back there. So you can see we've got a very accurate measurement of when the button is pressed, because it's coming from this machine here. We've also got a very accurate measurement of when the cerebral activity began, because it's measured here. But has anyone been sat there wondering, well, how did you measure this? The wanting to press the button. Because that seems pretty crucial, doesn't it? What they did, and they only had 5 test subjects, but ran the experiment 6 times, so they've got 30 test subjects in total. What they did, when they pressed the button, it stopped the clock. So you can see here it stopped at about 28 seconds. And they said to the test subjects, where was the dot when you decided to press the button? So they've got this really accurate measuring of when the button was pressed, a really accurate measuring of when the brain activity began, but here, they've just got this subjective report. Oh, well, it was just before. It was just
just ahead of the place where it stopped when I decided. Nobody said, for instance, that, well, I decided when it was on 5 seconds, but I've got a very slow mind and it took me. Even though they said, right, press now, it still took, no. There was nobody like that. No. They all reported deciding to press the button just before they successfully pressed the button. In fact, if you look at the data, it's only 200 milliseconds before, so it's 1/5 of a second. But here we're trusting the subjective report, so this seems a major methodological weakness that we've got. Two very accurate measurements, but this crucial measurement that it's a subjective report. Now, you could say, quite reasonably, well, what else could you have? You know, because there isn't yet a machine, as far as I know, that can measure when you have subjectively decided, I'm going to press the button. Because we've got the machine that's measuring the cerebral activity, but the whole point of this result is contrasting that with the conscious decision to press the button. So it's no good just measuring that. All we've got is the subjective report. But we are notoriously unreliable witnesses to our subjective experiences, including their temporal order, their temporal arrangement. Now, when you have memories, you may think, well, of course, one thing I remember is the order in which things occurred. So you could say, well, I remember dropping the glass, and then it was followed by the smashing of the glass, and then it was followed by the wine spreading across the floor. So there you can see there's a temporal order. But I'm going to suggest we are not perfect at this, especially when it comes to these small subjective things. So I may feel, if you ask me, when did you decide to press the button, I may well give you a report, but how reliable is that? Okay, so here's an experiment I'm going to go into in a bit of detail to undermine your belief that you really know the correct order in which things have occurred. Now, unfortunately, because I'm a PowerPoint novice, I wanted to have this animated, but it's not. I'm going to have to operate this manually. Okay, so you might not get this to begin with. Let me try, because I've got to get the speed exactly right. Now, did you see anything exciting there? Did it look to anyone, even slightly, as if there was a single dot moving from side to side on the screen? Maybe I didn't do it long enough. Let me just have one more go. You've got to get the speed just right. I have seen this done. Daniel Dennett had it on a monitor. I need to go faster. Does it look like it's a single dot moving from side to side? Well, at this stage you might think I'm a complete idiot. Why didn't you just animate that or ask somebody to do it? But I have something else prepared. But I am going to have to go out of PowerPoint. Now, here's a variance on what I've just shown you. And I think it's a bit more conclusive, because what we've got now is two pairs of dots. And you know when you look at a Necker cube, you can sometimes see it as if the bottom face is at the front, and then you can almost switch in your head and it's like the top face is at the front. Now here we've got two pairs of dots flashing on and off, and sometimes it looks as if it's a single dot moving top to bottom, and sometimes it looks as if it's a dot moving side to side. And they've got this the right speed. So, look at it for a while, and you might even suddenly see it differently.
think once the brain gets bored of seeing it one way, it might force you to see it another way. I'm looking at the screen. It's looking a bit to me, it's going top to bottom. I think you could maybe even see it. Oh! Yes, you can't say which direction to go in. Here's the guy who's presenting it. Right. Did everybody see something like that? Because you saw from my primitive PowerPoint presentation that I just actually, you know, there's only two dots. So there's no point at which there's a dot that is in between. And yet it can look to us, in order to look as if it's a single dot moving from side to side, it seems as if you see it somewhere in between at some point. Where I got the film from. Now, okay, you might say, okay, so what? It's a simple illusion. But I'm going to suggest that the way it's working is it's kind of appearing of it in your mind. It's as if at some point the dot's in between. It's not the dot on the left, it's not the dot on the right, somewhere in between. And then it goes there. But maybe you can see this already raises a puzzle. And this is the puzzle. You apparently seeing the dots somewhere in between. Yeah. That's caused by the fact that you've already seen it over the other side. Okay, so you see the dot here. This one flashes on and you have an appearance as if the dot's moving. But if the dot's moving, then it appears to be here before it's there. And yet what's caused you to see it moving is that you've seen that dot there. Do you see what I'm getting at? Your mind has rearranged the temporal order of events. You must have perceived this dot before you perceived it in the middle. And yet your mind's telling you it was in the middle moving across before it got there. You see what I'm saying? So this simple case is just to illustrate the point that we cannot be entirely reliable reporters of our own subjective experience, including the temporal order. An experiment that I think relies on a 200 millisecond gap between conscious wanting to press the button and an action, or between a 550 millisecond gap between some cerebral activity and you feeling that you had a conscious decision to press the button, cannot be relied on. Or it's insecure. In the spirit of science, we should be skeptical of that result. Now, on to some actual philosophy. Because you could say, well, what does philosophy add to this? You've got some scientific results and you've offered some skepticism because it seems to rely on something that we can't be certain of. But what will philosophy add to that besides? Well, for one thing, there are the big conceptual questions which have yet to be answered on for. What would free will consist in? What would you want to have in order to have free will? And I still think there's some big conceptual problems there. For one thing, if somebody's going to tell you, a neuroscientist, well, you didn't make the decision because your brain did, is that itself a conceptual confusion? You know, if I said, I didn't strangle the victim, my hands did. No court is going to let you off on that grounds, are they? Well, unless there's a very good story to tell. So the fact that your brain is
undergoing these changes that lead to you pressing the button.
Does that undermine the claim that it's you that's acting?
And what is it to decide? I mean, what constitutes a decision seems a big conceptual, philosophical question.
And I have no objection at all to philosophical inquiry going hand to hand with scientific inquiry, such as psychology. But I certainly think philosophers have got something to add. And here's another huge question in the free will debate. Is free will compatible with determinism or incompatible? So that's a philosophical discussion that's gone on for centuries. So even if the Newtonian picture were correct and we had an entirely deterministic world, there's still a question to answer whether free will is compatible with determinism. There's a long line of philosophical inquiry that says, actually, free will needs determinism. I'll explain why. But first, alternate possibilities. So here I'm going to make the first strides towards offering a solution to the free will problem, but I'm not going to get very far because I've only got 5 minutes left. But here's something it seems we feel we need for free will. So I started with a picture of the forest where it splits into two. We feel that for freedom we need there to be genuine alternate possibilities. So here, I can go through any of these 6 doors. And even if I choose to go through door number 4, it seems for me to have my freedom, it has to be a genuine possibility that I could have gone through door number 3 or door number 5 or any of them. So there's an intuition that for free will, you need genuine alternate possibilities. And this is the intuition that gets threatened by the possibility of determinism. So people say, if determinism is true, there are no genuine alternate possibilities. Because if you decide to go through door number 4, that's because it was determined that you did so. And there was never any possibility that you went through door number 1. So that's the alternate possibilities. Determinism threatens alternate possibilities. But here's another difficulty. And here you might think, well, there's no chance at all for free will. Suppose determinism is false. Suppose we live in an indeterministic world. Well, that threatens something else that we feel is vital for free will, namely ultimate authorship. So if I feel that my decision to step to the left or to the right wasn't determined, so you could think, woohoo, yes, maybe I'm free. But if I tell you, well, it was indeterminate, it was actually pure chance. It was as if a little fellow in your brain tossed a coin, and if it was heads, you were going left, and if it was right, tails, you were going right. So if it's a matter of pure chance whether you step to the left or to the right, that doesn't seem like freedom either. So with determinism, it seems I'm a slave to necessity. With indeterminism, it seems I'm a slave to pure chance. Either way, I've got no free will. We want ultimate authorship of our actions. This guy wants to say it was him that sunk the putt. And if it turns out it was just pure chance, it was indeterminate that he sinks the putt, he's going to think he's lost authorship of his actions. So if someone says, well, it was purely a matter of pure chance whether you went to the left or to the right, I would feel, well, it wasn't really me that did it. It was pure chance that stepped to the left or to the right. So this seems a real problem. So although I'm saying science cannot easily disprove the possibility of free will, I'm not saying that free will's an easy thing to explain either. Philosophers can, on their own, show that free will's a big difficulty. Because if determinism threatens the possibility of alternatives, and indeterminism threatens the possibility of authorship of our actions, it looks like we're screwed either way. But looks like there's no free will. But although philosophers are good at making problems, raising problems for everyone, we do occasionally attempt to solve the problems as well. So, causation. So, here's an attempt at a solution to the problem of free will based on a particular understanding of causation. So this is what Rani and I have worked on this over a number of years. Slowly, but there's no rush in philosophy because it can take centuries sometimes. So one idea that we've had is that we need a proper understanding of causation in order to see how we can have a solution to the free will problem. So by causation, that's a philosopher's term. Causation, this is what David Hume called the perfect instance. This is where one billiard ball crashes into another. The cue ball hitting the object ball causes the object ball to move. And there's various ways in which that could be understood. One way would be, well, the object ball would not have moved had the cue ball not struck it. Another way you could understand it is that the first event made the second event happen. So first of all, there's a striking of the cue into the cue ball. So the cue striking the ball caused the first ball to move, and then it hits the second ball and causes that to move, and you can see the way this is all set up, it's going to cause all the balls to move. So this is what we mean by causation, and the relevance to the free will debate is that we have causes acting upon us all the time. And sometimes those causes acting upon us make us do things. So maybe you know, you could have a clever psychologist who knows how to cause somebody to do something else, even if they may not make a conscious decision to do so. So I heard of a very funny experiment that some students once performed on their lecturer. They conspired before class and decided that everybody on the left side of the class would smile at the lecturer, make eye contact, and nod and look as if they were really enjoying the lecture. And all the students on the right side decided they were going to look down and bored, not much eye contact, no smiling. And during the course of the lecture series, they managed to get this lecturer with this very distinctive twisted spine because there was such a preference to the left side. So psychologists know that they can act upon a test subject and get them to behave in a certain way. So causation is important because it can make us do things. And sometimes make us do things that you might feel compromises our free will. But causation is also important because we ourselves are causes of our own actions. We make changes to the world. So I can pick up this glass. The glass is elevated purely because of my action. So we have causes acting upon us, and we also enact causes. Things are done to us, and we also do things. So this is why causation is so important to free will. When you're acting freely, you're causally exercising your powers. You're making changes to the world. But then you've got causes acting upon you. Now, Rani and I and a few other people have a particular view of causation, that it doesn't involve necessity. And this seems to be a key thing for free will. So there are some philosophers who articulate determinism in terms of causation. So there's a quote from Daniel Dennett I could give you, the idea that determinism is when the current event has a cause, which had a cause, which had a cause, and maybe that goes right back to the Big Bang. But what's doing the deterministic work is the idea that causes necessitate their effects. And if you understand causation that way, you can see how it threatens alternate possibilities. Because if a cause acts on you and makes you do something, and it did so through necessitation, then there was never an alternate possibility that you didn't act in that way. So if causation involves necessitation, it seems to threaten our freedom. But we have a conception of causation that doesn't involve necessitation. The idea is that causes tend towards their effects in a way that's less than necessity, but more than pure chance. So when I strike a match, the reason I do so is I know there's a strong tendency, and tendencies can come in degrees of strength. There's a very strong tendency for struck matches to light. And we all know that a struck match doesn't light in every single case, but it tends to do so. Ronnie mentioned we have a book on tendencies coming out shortly. This is where you can get all the background information on that. But crucially for the case of free will, we can have causes acting upon us that may tend us in a certain direction, but still some alternate possibilities are left open because a cause doesn't necessitate its effect. And here's the trick, almost by magic, this very same notion of causation allows us to retain ultimate authorship as well. Because when I exercise my causal powers and I hit the ball towards the hole, well, if it goes in, it was certainly my action, even if what I did didn't necessitate the outcome. So a gust of wind could have come just at the wrong time and the ball not go in. Or even a squirrel could have run across and stolen the ball. So these things weren't within my control. But I was still exercising all my causal powers to produce this outcome. If I sink the putt, it is indeed my action, and I think it's right that I have responsibility for it. So, because I only had a few minutes there, I've only given you the basic sketch of a theory of free will, a philosophical one, which I would argue would survive even in the face of Libet's experimental data. And we've given more detail in these recent publications. But I think now I should stop and invite any questions.